Well, I got out of high school in 55 and went to work at the shoe factory. That's where my dad, mother, and brother, sisters worked. And worked there for a year and a half, didn't like that. And I had a cousin, Mac Thompson. He was involved with the state police then, and he said he'd get me a job with the FBI. And sort of, I was a fingerprint technician. And but I had to go to Washington, D.C. I had a good job, but I didn't like Washington, D.C., so he wrote him a letter and asked him if he could get me a job down here. So he did. He had to have a pull then to go to work for the state police.
That's Mac Thompson. That was my cousin. Got me my job, and felt I was always real fond of. And this was Tom Cry. He was my post sergeant till he retired, and one of my best friends I ever had.
I went to work for them in 1957, July the 1st, 1957. Then you had to be 25 to be a trooper, and I was just 20, so I had to work in the office for 3 or 4 years. I worked radio, gave the inside part of the driver's test, just worked in record section, and until I was old enough to be a trooper. And when I first became a trooper, I was single, and they used me as a relief trooper. If trooper quit somewhere or got fired or got killed, well, they'd send me there to work that area until they got a replacement. And I worked around Little Rock some, worked at Pine Bluff a while, you know, a few weeks. And then trooper Texarkana got killed in 61. They sent me down there. When they replaced him, me and Mary got married January 12th, 62, we moved back to Little Rock, worked there a while, then went back to Texarkana, worked there a couple of years. Then I was transferred to Wynn, Arkansas, which is in Cross County, down close to Forest City. And then in 67, I was transferred to Jonesboro. And I spent the rest of my career at Jonesboro, retired in June 30th, 1994, worked 37 years long. I went to, that's a picture of my state police troop school I went to. There's 36 of us. That's made in 1960. And there I am there. About half those boys are dead now. Some of them was killed. Most of them died of natural causes. But we spent a month down there training. It wasn't a real good paying job, but it had good benefits. And there just always something happening. It was an exciting job. And of course, we spent most of our time looking for drunks, working radar, and investigating accidents. That was the main part of our job, trying to get drunks off the road before they hit someone, keeping people slowed down, enforcing traffic laws. But there's always something going on. Most time when I worked highway patrol, my area was north. I'd work 141, 351 at Airport Road. And of course, all the clubs then was on Airport Road, Eagle Lodge, Moose Lodge, VFW, and we got a lot of drunks out of there. We generally take a break about 11 because Cap Spear didn't want us, he wants out on the road after 12 when most of the drunks started. And I told the boys, I'm gonna go on Airport Road and see if I can find me a drunk. And I was driving right along in here about the cemetery, and one hit me in the rear end, knocked my hat back there, wrecked my rear of my car. He was drunk as he could be. I run over a state trooper, and they've kidded me for several weeks there about I really found me a drunk, and I did. Now, I had a lot of good friends that was in state police.
That was the post up here, Poinsett Creek, Head County, in 1970. All my good friends on there, that's Plug Eaton, he's already dead. And Jerry Souter, one of my best friends. That's Waylon Spear, Aaron Jackson, Stan McMillan, one of my best friends.
Now, like I say, when I moved to Lake City, I was a rookie just starting. And you know, in the past, people tell you, you know, if you go in a new job or go in a new situation, why you kind of pick out the oldest fellow there, you know, and kind of stand back and watch him, and you learn from him. And when I met Dale, I kind of figured he was about the oldest fellow around at that time. And I kind of watched him work and his in the ways he done things, and I learned a lot from Dale. And he was kind of like a grandfather figure to me, you know. I learned a lot from him, and some things I can talk about, and some things I can't. You know, it's one of them situations. You know, he had all kinds of trades.
Well, I appreciate you calling me and. You know, asking me to speak about Dale Miller, and that brings me matter of fact, we discussed this. Where's the envelope at that I talked to you about? If you wanted me to talk about Dale, hold on just a second. We'll take just a second. Okay, that's the price we agreed on for me to say some nice things about him. So yes. I appreciate you doing that. I hate to charge you, but you know, this is a difficult assignment.
I've known Dale a long time, but got to know him a lot better. Of course, I knew the family forever, and they kind of grew up with my dad. But when I was trying to go to work for state police, I was working City Water Light, and Dale used to come by and pick me up. We'd go. I'd ride with him on the weekends, and one of the first nights I rode with him was. I'd never seen it to what I knew would be a drunk driver. We were traveling, going up towards Brooklyn. We were between Hilltop and Farmville, as a two-lane road then. Got behind an obvious drunk driver. And so when we stopped the guy down around Farmville, Dale stopped him and got out. I just sat in the car, and he walked up, and it was obvious the guy was drunk. Well, when he got him out of the car, I recognized this guy. I mean, first, you know, probably the first night I'd ever rode with Dale, and it was a guy I worked with at City Water and Light. I said, this ain't gonna be good. And Dale kidded me today, because I kind of slid down in the seat.
I remember the first time I got in the car with him. Dale would drive the car. I seen him drive from Little Rock to Jonesboro several times. He'd sit on his left foot. The first time I got in the car with him, I looked at him. I thought he'd a one-legged man. Couldn't figure out what state police done working a one-legged state trooper, you know, and I finally figured out he's sitting on his foot. So
I'm just going to have to be truthful and honest about this. When your son called me, you know, I did write some things down and some real nice things about you. He asked me to, so I told John, I said, get me a pen while this is fresh on my mind, and I just started writing down all the nice things that I could think about you, Dale Miller. And I just so many of them, I just don't think I can remember them. So let me just read what I wrote down of all the nice things. I've got that piece of paper right here somewhere. Right here it is. And just a minute, right here, yeah. The nice things about Dale Miller. And the reason I know this, and the reason I can say what I'm fixing to say about one of the nice things about you, is it came from a great source. And it says, Dale Miller, what can you say nice about him? And I wrote down here, he's consistent. And the reason I'm able to do that is because I got that from a great source, and that was Captain Waylon Spears. Because I always remember Captain Spears making the statement. He said, you know, Dale Miller is so consistent. And I thought that was a pretty good compliment. Then he went ahead and added, because he's consistently causing problems and keeping things stirred up. So I guess you could read that any way you wanted to, Dale, but that's about the nicest thing I ever heard.
Just before I went to work, and I was riding with Dale one Saturday night, and wasn't much going on, and we were kind of hunting something to do, and he got a call up on 141 Highway that there's a drunk out in the middle of the road up there. So we shoot off up there and try to beat everybody to get there. A couple of other troopers were out, but Dale wanted to get up there and have something to do. So sure enough, got up there and this old drunk right out in the middle of the road. And Dale pulled the car over pulled his car over and got out, and the old guy's down in the middle of the road. But, well, there's a nursing home right there across the street. We didn't put two and two together. Dale puts him in the back seat, and I'm in the front seat. Well, Dale walks around out looking in the ditch and just see if he could find anything. Well, it was obvious to me that this guy had the worst BO, or he had had a ferocious bowel movement. It was terrible. I mean, it stunk. Well, Dale gets in the car, and he's looking at me like I'd done something. I mean, I ain't done nothing. He thought he had just, and there's this kid, it is so bad, I'd never smelled anything like it. Well, we go to jail. The closer we get to jail, we got all the windows rolled down. This old guy, he just acts like he's bad drunk and get up at the jail, and it's absolutely running people out of the jail. Well, of course, proper procedure is you need to search him. Well, we didn't do a very good job of searching him out there. Well, we get up to jail, and Dale says, I guess I better search him a little bit. And he patted him down. He felt something in his back hip pocket, and he run his hand down that hip pocket and in that back pocket and brought it out. And this old man, it turned out he'd run away from that nursing home, and he'd filled his britches up, and he took his underwear off and put them in his back pocket. When Dale brought them out, it was just full of, you know what? Everybody at the jail got sick. I mean, I thought we could like to never got the smell out of his car.
We went on a few raids together. I remember one in particular, Mississippi County, that we went into a gambling joint and in a dance hall. And of course, Dale was always kind of a featherweight, you know, and a little wiry, but he's a featherweight. So we went into this club to clean it out. And we just cleaned it all out. Looked back there, and Dale and this lady was, I didn't at first, I thought there might have been a dancing, you know. And it looked like it might have been a clogging or something, but I come find out that's kind of fighting. And that featherweight done picked on him a heavyweight. they was causing quite a bit of damage to the establishment. And but he won the battle, and they come out. When they come out, they was kind of doing like the line dancing, you know. They was line dancing to the door. but we had several situations like that that you look back on, it's funny. And my experience, it was funny right then. wasn't so much to Dale, I don't think, but everybody else, we enjoyed it. You ever see a heavyweight and a featherweight? I have one time.
The police work is, it's blowed up. I worked 37 years, and I was in 3 shooting incidents in 37 years, and I never shot anybody. I was, seemed like I always wanted getting shot at, but it's you don't have the shooting incidents that it shows on TV, but you do have a lot of high-speed chases.
You know, what an opportunity for me. Here I am, and for years, for the last, what has it been, 30 years, I've had to live with this story that you've always told about this chase you were involved in. Never have I had the opportunity to really tell my side of it. And your son has told me today that for the first time I could go on record with my side, and of course, you know, there's always been quite a bit of difference in it.
I was, one of the chases I had, the longest one I guess I ever had was, up in this area. In fact, come out and see my mother and dad. They lived out here, and they called me and said someone had just robbed this store down south here, driving a little white Mustang with 4 white males in it.
I had been to Little Rock that day, and I was on my way back, and I heard Dale Miller get into a chase.
Well, I got in my car, and as I started back out, the car went by. It was gravel road out here then, so I took off after it.
So he gets in, he spots him, and he gets in pursuit of him. And for some reason, he lets this thing escalate into just an all-out, chase like nobody in Northeast Arkansas has ever heard before.
And we went all over these county roads, high speeds. I'd get up beside of him, he'd try to run me off the road.
And your dad got up there and he crossed over, and I got there and I turned west in Mona on this gravel road, and I could see the dust over on another gravel road, and I could see the flicker of the lights off your dad's police car. And so I started just running parallel with him and looking over, and he was, of course, I don't even know that I could imitate him the way he was talking on the radio that day. It was, well, for a grown man, it's pretty, a state trooper, it's pretty pathetic. Yeah. He was almost just squealing, like, help me, help me. I mean, it was like, I'm about to run out of gas, please, somebody help me.
This went about 43 miles, anyway, wound up way over here at Egypt.
Well, a lot of folks called after that. You know, they'd come out with those old scanners then. And a lot of folks called and thought we'd hired our first female trooper.
And finally went, got the road blocked, go out to us, finally blocked the road that's on.
You know, they run all these roadblocks. All these people he called for had let him down, every one of them. Nobody been able to help him. He's on the radio screaming just like he just got in the police car for the first day. And here I am, a rookie trooper, cool and calm. I said, Dale, I said, I'm up here. I said, it's me, everything's gonna be okay. I said, just bring them on to me and I'll take care of them. Oh, it was just like, oh, thank you, thank you. And here they were, and about that time, those old boys saw me. And when they saw me, I think they might have recognized me. You know, that, that's Trooper Todd. And I think that might have, a little element of fear might have set in. Because they knew then things would get down to business. And so instead of coming up and having an encounter with me, which was really a good decision on their part, they turned, and the only place they had to turn, because I just blocked the road, was across these people's, in these people's driveway.
And I had to go down through this old farmer's yard. And he was sitting on the front porch, and gosh, he was running over his chickens, and them chickens was flying.
And I guess it was kind of like out of a movie. There this man and woman was sitting on the front porch, and they were in their rocking chairs. And this old boy that Dale had been chasing, he turns and goes into this driveway, and he just goes across these people's yard. Well, Dale's right in behind them. And then, of course, I crank up, and I'm right in behind Dale. And we all three, and they've got chickens. Chickens are flying. They're going up in there, and those people are just like this. They're just watching. There goes the bad guys. There goes Dale, and there I go. We go around the side of their house, off of their back, through their backyard, and out here is this freshly, you know, it's not during farming season, so these farmers have got their fields all disked and plowed up, and it's muddy. You got those little canals running out across it.
Went on across the front yard and down through a little soybean field. The mud was about ankle deep, and had a little ditch down there. And he jumped the ditch, and I jumped the ditch. Of course, it disabled both cars when we hit the other side. This, all these jumping you see don't really happen, because when a car hits the other side, it burnt both of our radiators through our fan blades through it.
I can't tell you what speed they hit that little old drainage canal. They come out the other side. And wow, it's all that. And I thought, oh, man. Dale went up there, he hit it just like they did, and boom, he bounced out the other side. I thought, I'm not going to make that mistake.
Dwight Tosh, who was following me, his car, he hit the bank and did $500 or $600 damage.
So I go up there and I let off, and when I go down in it, I don't have enough speed to come out the other side. And the old front fenders on that police car mine just buckled like it.
The old boys jumped out then. I thought, I was a lot like this old dog chased the car. I was out there in the field by myself. I caught them, but there's four of them. First one jumped out, and I knocked him in the head with my nightstick, sort of trying to get my bluff in on them. But the driver, and got them under cover, the driver, he jumped out and run. So I took off after him and crossed that old muddy field. I thought I'd run him down, but that old gumbo was up half knee deep. And I'd run about 100 yards. And I looked up and I wasn't any closer to him once I started. So I just took my pistol out. And I didn't really shoot at him. I shot over his head where he could hear it.
So I jump out with my slap. Of course, I'm running across that old muddy field. And when I get up there, one of these old boys he's got out of the car on Dale. And he's taking off running. And when I get there, Dale says, you get him and I'll go get that one. So I reach in and I get this old boy out of the car and I lay him across the trunk of the car. And I've got his face laying down on the trunk and I'm holding his head down. And then I hear, boom! I thought, oh no. And I hear, "You better stop." And I won't go any further with what, how he described the guy he was chasing. I'll leave that to your own, let you draw your own conclusions as to what was said. But anyways, and this old boy in the trunk, he tried to raise up because he's thinking, has he shot him? Has he shot my buddy? And of course, I'm thinking, well, he may have, but I don't need him to witness this, so I'd put him back down on the trunk.
And he give up until I got up there, then he's gonna take off again.
You know, I'm watching and they disappear. And I've got this old boy, and of course, I have a little talk with him. I'll put it that way.
I popped him one, then had to take him to the hospital. Had 8 stitches in the back of his head. I didn't mean to hit him that hard. I was just going to keep him running. But
in a little bit, here comes Dale back across that field. He's got this old boy, and boy fall down. He'd drag him a little bit, and he'd pick him back up, and boy fall down, of course. And when he got back to the car, he looked at the old boy that I had on the trunk, and Dale said, "What in the world happened to him?" I said, "He had an accident." And I said, "Well, what happened to him?" He said he had a worse accident. I said, "I believe he did." So anyways, so then we get to the park. We've got 2 wrecked police cars out in this field. And so we get to try and tell people where we're at. And finally, we don't even know where we're at, but finally we get people in there and we get this thing all tidied up and we get them out of there and they get a tractor and get our police cars out. We tore up 2 police cars.
Come find out what this robbery was. They'd got $12 worth of gas and didn't pay for it. So we'd tore up 3 cars and had to take that young gentleman to the hospital and get him sewed up. So it cost state police quite a bit of money to get that $12 back.
So I'm at home that night. My phone rings. My wife said, "Captain Spears wants to talk to you." I said, "Oh, me?" So I said, "Hey, Kevin." He said, "Hey, I need to talk to you a minute." He said, "I got a call from these boys' mother." And I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah." And he said, "They're telling me that the boys look pretty bad. Both of them look like their old eyes are swollen and lips are kind of, you know, just don't look good. And they're claiming that you and Dale might have kind of whooped up on them a little bit out there." And he said, "I need to know, did y'all hadn't said anything about this, something like that happened." I said, "Captain, you need to remember this." I said, "That's them boys' mom." I said, "You know, that's probably the only people in the world that really loves them." And I said, "They're out there driving." I said, "They jumped the canal." I said, "They didn't even have any seat belts on." I said, "When they went across that thing at 75 miles an hour, it probably bounced them all over that car, because I know when we were dragging them out, they were bleeding everywhere." And I said, then Dale had chased that one down around across the field. I had tried to stay there with that other one. And I said, "Those boys got all those injuries from, you know, getting banged around in that car." I said, he said, well, "I'm gonna call Dale Miller." He said, "You better hope he tells me the same story." And I said, "Well, I believe he will." And the reason I believe that, because Dale and I had already got those stories together earlier that night, so I wasn't really worried about that.
He was just an old thug, always has been, always will be. They won't ever get him in anything or straighten him out. But a casket, I think I'd straighten him out. But anyway, I straightened him out that day.
You know, I guess what shocked me after that was here I had actually saved a day. You know, I mean, I had come through like a champ. Did I ever hear from Dale Thaw, thank you, you know, here you were, right there where I needed you. Now, the only thing I ever heard was, I showed up at his retirement party, and he gets there before all of this. I can't tell you, there's a lot of folks there at Troop C that day at his retirement party. I'm standing in the back of the room, drove all the way over from Newport, thought that much of my old buddy. And what do I hear? He tells about this chase, and you know, it sounded good. If he'd have just left it there, we'd have been fine. But no, he has to end this thing by saying, "I never thought in my life I'd be glad to see Dwight Tosh, but I was that day." And everybody just laughed. And I thought, now here I am, the one guy he could count on, and how does he do? But anyways, I always thought that was a great story. And that was probably one of the wildest chases that ever happened. And Dale Miller and I, we did a good job that day, and he knows it.
I don't know. I never did do anything heroic. I was in with groups of people that did a lot of heroic things. State Police started SWAT teams in 83, and each troop had one, and I was the only sergeant up here that could do the PT, the running and everything, so I was over it. And so if anything, from then on, anything's going on, well, I was always called. With my SWAT team had about 8 men on it. This was my original SWAT team. That's was some snipers, Stan McMillan, John Purcell. That's Roger Peary, Phil Carter, Randy Toome, Jerry Brogdon, Larry Faulkner.
I got acquainted with him best when they formed a SRT team, and Dale was in charge of it. He was a supervisor over it, and we went into many situations where could have got hurt, but nobody did, and I give Dale a lot of credit for that, for his supervision, and I'll have to give him credit for handling situations. When we went into situations a lot of times, and some other department or whatever had already tried and failed, and then they would call us, and under Dale's supervision, we handled every situation we went into.
Any kind of situation, someone hole up in the house, that was what they mostly called as far as someone get holed up in the house and get shooting while they'd send us there. And we had a couple of snipers on the team. We'd put them around the house and in case they come out shooting at us, and then we'd get up close enough, throw tear gas in there. That's how we generally get them out. Also, while I was on SWAT team, they had a CSA thing at Harrison where some nuts got together there. They didn't think about obeying the law.
Covenant Sword and Arm of the Lord Outlaws all went crazy, and we were up there. That's one of the better assignments we had over the years, as far as being an important assignment. It was really, it could have got dangerous, but we had a lot of good times up there on that. But it all worked out well. But there were some hairy times on that thing too. It scared to death, but wasn't nothing you could do. I remember we were looking at a map. Larry Taylor and I were laying. We spent the night out there. Taylor and I were laying beside some stumps and logs, and up next to this compound. The next morning, it got light enough we could read our map and looked at it, and it showed there were landmines there where we were laying. And of course, we went trying to holler at Dale to get us out of there. He made the stay in there. Turned out he knew that them landmines had already been blown up, but we didn't.
Well, just a bunch of things, about like they had at Waco. And they sent us in there, and State Police and the FBI and all the SWAT teams, and we surrounded them, blocked the roads, and just started starving them out, cut the electricity off, and they gave up. Wouldn't have shot far up there, but it could have been. It was they had a couple of fellas on the most wanted list was in there. They had more automatic rifles than we had, than the whole State Police had. But anyway, they decided to give up instead of fight. One of the bright spots of my career was one of my trooper friends, Danny Brown's dad, was murdered at Leesville. And we looked for that fella we searched for him a week. He just hit the woods running and hiding. And finally, myself and Bill Hook caught him over around Lake City. Rusty Speaks was over there fishing and saw him in a thicket out there. We went up there, surrounded him, and caught him. And of course, that was a thrill to catch the old boy that killed one of your friends dead and be one of the officers that caught him. The worst part of the State Police job was delivering death messages, having to work a wreck where someone was killed and having to go tell the family, and something I dreaded doing, didn't like it at all, but occasionally you would have to do it, and that was the dirtiest thing that had to do. I didn't mind the manhunts and the fighting of drunks, but I'd have rather fought 3 or 4 drunks as go deliver one death message. And I didn't fight near as much as my dad, even though I was a policeman. I had some fights, it was just when I had to, but of course I was in a line of business that, you know, you had to fight.
Craig, I can remember so many people talking good about your daddy. And the thing that surprised me, I always knew him all my life, but the thing that surprised me is how the big rough and tough troopers always wanted Dale with them when they was getting ready to go into a hairy situation. Jerry Souter, I've heard him testify about Odell when Dale wasn't around on many occasions, and he always said, I'll take Dale Miller over any of the big guys anytime because Odell wouldn't leave you. If he was going to Rivervale or if he was going on a manhunt in Mississippi County, he liked it when Dale was with him. Plug Eaton always spoke good about Dale's bravery, and I always thought that spoke volumes.
Well, it was Wayne Malone's who it was. And he was sitting in the car with me, and I was telling him, you know, a few things, and Dale got in his chase. And got up 63 north, and then it hit 18 headed east, and I made a statement to Wayne. I said, well, I better get out there, because there's going to be a fight. And Wayne said, well, Dale fight? I said, yeah, he worried. When Wayne and I got to where Dale finally had this boy stopped, they was in a little scuffle, and the boy didn't want to get in the car. So after they scuffled a while, he decided he better get in the car. Then it seemed like Dale wasn't ready for him to get in the car yet. So it just, he wanted the scuffle to last a little longer. So, but when Dale finally gave him the opportunity, he was very ready to get in the car. He was glad to get in there. So that's when Wayne kind of got a different opinion of Dale. He said, boy, that little man's kind of worried, ain't he? So I said, well, I told you that before we got here. But that's one of the things I remember about Dale. He might have been a featherweight, but he was pretty wiry.
One of the stories that I remember the best was one I was personally involved in, and I never shall forget it. It must have been 20, 25 years ago. It was about 1982 or 3, somewhere along in there. Dale was a post sergeant, highway patrol here in Craighead. And this was 10:30, 11 o'clock at night. I was headed back to Poncho's. So I was headed west on Pleasant View Road coming from the church back to 351. And as I approached that stop sign, there was nothing going on. All of a sudden, just out of the clear, was a white, unmarked state police car that I recognized as Dale Miller's, and he was making a power slide right in front of me, and my headlights were on bright, and I saw it was Roger Perry was riding shotgun. He was a trooper in Troop C at that time, Highway Patrol, and just like a rocket had been shot out, or a cannon, a rocket took off. Dale took off north, and I didn't know what was going on, but he headed north, apparently after a speeder. I went ahead and turned left and started going down toward Hilltop, where Junior Foods is now. And as I was going down, I was driving along the speed limit, and all of a sudden there about the water tire, there was a car went around me, passed me on a double yellow at the water tire, just like I was sitting on a jack. Just went by me. And I said, this may be something to do with Dale, who Dale was chasing. So I speeded up, and that guy went through the intersection, of course, didn't stop, and turned to the right, which was headed back down toward the stadium. Well, there was Junior Foods was on the south side of East Johnson then, along with Phil and Karen's daycare center. And I got to the intersection just to see that car making a hard left right on Jewel Drive, right beside Junior Food, going back toward where y'all lived. You lived down in there. Gary Withrow lived back around there. Phil and Karen lived up in Despain Cove. Drew Suter lived up in the cul-de-sac on Despain Cove. And Vern Barnett lived on a dead-end street right around on the next street that joined that Despain Cove. I saw the car turn left with that road, but Dale didn't. And all of a sudden, that same white unmarked state police car comes sliding by me. There was not a light there then. He was out in the middle of the intersection, and there again, he shot like a rocket. But he didn't see the instant Dale did not see that car that he was chasing turn on that side road by for Junior Food, and he took off down toward stadium. And I got down to the middle of East Johnson Avenue, and I turned my lights on bright trying to get his attention, and I couldn't. Well, he went on. Well, I said, I'll just turn. I was driving the little Datsun truck, and I said, I'll just turn and see if I can see where that car went. And I went down and went by your house and turned left, and dogged that car wasn't coming back down from Vern Barnett's. He'd got up there and run into that dead end, and he come back, and I just went crazy. Turned my truck right in front of him, turned my lights on bright and kind of blinded him. I didn't have a gun. And I got out, and I started talking like Buren Jackson. All right, get out of that car as fast as you can. And he got out, and I kind of spooked him, and he went up on the hood, and I didn't have any cuffs or anything, and so I took him by the back of the coat, And I didn't know what I was gonna do. Cell phones weren't around, radios weren't available. So I just said, I'll just walk him up to Phil's house and have him to call the state police and tell them this is who he's looking for, I bet. I walked over to Phil's house. They had that long driveway, walked up the driveway with him and knocked on the front door, and Kayram's already in the bed. It was after 11 o'clock. And she finally got her gown, or her robe on, and came to the door. And about that time, I saw the little white unmarked car that Dale and Roger was driving come back up to Spain Cove, where I was. And so I hollered back, told her, forget it. I went walking back down the driveway, that long concrete driveway of Phil and Kayram's. And Dale just pulled up at the end of the driveway, stopped and got out. And he was as jolly and laughing. He said, hey, deputy, you got my man, don't you? I said, yeah. And I still had him by the back of the collar. He was a pretty good sized guy. He was a lot bigger than me. And he's bigger than Dale, too. And we got down to the foot of that driveway, and old Dale was easy going and kind of grinning a little bit. And we got close enough to him, he changed and he went from Jekyll to Hyde. And it scared me, and I knew Dale all my life. And he swelled up and he rained all over that boy, clouded up and rained on him. And the whole time he was talking to him, he got him slung across that car and put the cuffs on him and put him head first in that little old car. And his old big fanny was stuck up in there. And old Dale took that big boot and placed it right where he sat. And he went all the way across that car and hit his head on the other door, slammed that door and turned around, and as quick as he got mad, he got glad, just that quick. And he went from Jekyll to Hyde back to Jekyll, from cold to hot to cold, and I was amazed in that all that 30 seconds was standing there, and I said, I saw the real Dale Miller right there, and I like both of them. But Dale was never afraid. It went on, and he was the one drag racing up there, and they got him into trouble and went ahead and put him in the jail and everything. But that story, I should never forget it, because I saw firsthand what I'd always heard the other troopers talk about. He wasn't afraid of anything, anybody, any situation, and I always admired him for that.
All the time I was a policeman, I wanted to be known as just one of the boys. I didn't want to be known as a super cop or anything like that. Just an old boy that if you went into fight with him, I was going to be there with you, and one that people respected, and I think they did.
I've had a little fun with him here, but Dale Miller is a good trooper. Was a great trooper.
Dale did a lot to help me go to work, and him and Mac Thompson and them. If it hadn't been them, I'd never made it, because I wasn't smart enough on my own. But he was always good to work for, and you know, we still miss him around here.
And he was my post sergeant for several years, and I couldn't ask for any better. I couldn't name anyone any better I'd rather have than Dale Miller. And when he told you something, we used to take it to the bank.
And Dale was the kind of person who always would make you feel good with just the smile he had. That was truly a gift he had to make you feel at ease and good.
You know, I was young, especially as a radio operator, and I mean, I thought these guys hung the moon. And he was one of those guys that you could always talk to. You know, he was always level-headed. And you just count on him. And he always had a good attitude. I mean, and you know, he exemplified what I always felt like was the kind of attitude and approach things the West State Trooper should. He was easy to get along with, and you know, and always called him my friend. And you know, to be able to say that, I guess says it all.
It's a good career, not one I'd want my son or grandson to follow. But it was right for me. Got me out of the cotton patch.
Just doing my job on the highway patrol.